Katoon Vishun. There's an old Indian shrine hidden away in the back streets of Bangkok's garment district. Not listed in any guidebooks, it would take a page to explain how to get there. Tourists aren't welcome anyway. The E on the entrance sign has been tampered with, so now it reads entrance. It's a place where deals are sealed, dreams are perceived, and deaths are foretold. The gods here aren't worshipped. Their presence is more akin to guard dogs. A narrow path is flanked by tall statues of ferocious Indian deities that stare down at visitors. Scornful eyes scare away the craven and the spiritless. The further inside you venture, the darker it gets. It's like walking into a black hole. A cranky old air conditioning unit makes a big fuss about keeping the place a few degrees cooler than a sauna. Hidden behind a dusty picture of the elephant god Ganesh is a small door to a secret room. No bigger than a broom cupboard, black dust covers the walls, steadfastly refusing to give any hint of what color lies beneath. The room is dominated by a life-size statue of a young Indian girl. Her sleepy eyes gaze down at her bare feet. A low buzzing sound seems to be emitting from her tilted head. As you edge closer, you notice it's coming from a small hole on her right cheek. Her name is Katoon Vishun. Visits to the shrine are strictly by appointment only. The date, time, and donation are all determined at a consultation with the head monk. Hard cash is exchanged for personalized coins that are offered to Katoon Vishun. The cost is never the same. Artisan monks skilled in the ancient art of coinage make them by placing a blank piece of metal between two engraved dies. Then they strike the upper die with a hammer to replicate a unique design on both sides of the coin. The dull gray coins have round holes in their center. As you place the coin at Katoon Vishun's feet, two teenage monks approach. They motion you to bend down and peer into a tiny portal on Katoon Vishun's cheek. Apologizing first, they gently grip your head and hold it firmly in place. A small pinpoint of white light appears deep inside the black hole. Your one-eyed vision locks onto it. Shimmering slightly, the light starts moving and unwinds from its center at an ever-increasing distance. As the speed and intensity increases, trails of light appear to form a spiral that quickly encompasses your entire field of vision. Without warning, the monks suddenly begin chanting in low, dulcet tones. Right on cue, the trails of light grow larger, forming a spherical spiral. the curves of an infinite number of revolutions. The center is stained with vivid colors, red, blue, yellow, and green. Kaleidoscopic patterns, like dividing cells, commit to more recognizable shapes, and you begin to make out two eyes staring back at your own lone eye. The instinctive urge to pull away is countered by the firm grip of the two young monks. As the eyes pull back and the face around them appears, you realize that the stare isn't menacing, and it isn't a stranger. It's the one that greets you every morning in the mirror. But something still isn't right. It takes you a moment to process the anomaly, and then, capiche! The face staring back at you and grinning like a fool is an animated cartoon of your own face. The moment of realization is punctuated by an ear-splitting, tacky game show buzzer. Really, though, you shouldn't have been surprised to see that familiar face staring back at you, because you knew, before you popped that creepy coin at her feet, that you'd be the star attraction in this production. The big question that you coughed up the cash for is one that has preyed on the mind of man since he first discovered his own mortality. Katoon Vishun is the key that unlocks the age-old question, how will death finally take me? Very little about the ritual is revealed beforehand, so most are shocked when the death prediction appears in an animated cartoon. But scratch any expectations of slick Pixar or conceptual anime. This is a pure Looney Tunes production, laced with slapstick routines, wacky sound effects, and canned laughter. If your final destiny is being mowed down by a drunk driver late one night, then the sloshed motorist would be a red-nosed, puffy-faced drunk with heavy eyes and a 5 o'clock shadow. He'd be spluttering out the last lines of Bon Jovi's Living on a Prayer when suddenly, swerve, screech, crash. The car rams into you at full speed, drags you several feet before leaving your body in a mangled mess at the side of the road. Tire marks across your body, birds and stars spinning above your head. Then, the plinky plonky soundtrack stops abruptly. The canned laughter echoes as it fades out, and a somber piano plays the death march. A grinning Grim Reaper appears, brandishing a handwritten game over sign. That's it, the end, Finn. In a dreary hospital room, the gaunt body of a leukemia patient is hooked up to a multitude of machines, including the requisite life support machine, a chemotherapy machine. He's also plugged into a toaster, fax machine, and vacuum cleaner. Flowers in the vase next to the bed look lifeless and wilted. Flies circle around a dirty porcelain bedpan. Slits of bright white sunlight steal their way through the dusty Venetian blinds onto the patient's wizened face, just to taunt him one last time. A discordant interpretation of the William Tell overture fades in as the scene jerks and shifts into fast-forward mode. Faceless nurses dash in and out as they check his temperature, give him bed baths, have hushed phone conversations with boyfriends on the edge of his bed, and flick through copies of Marie Claire. And all the while, the patient moans, groans, and wastes away, until an alarm beeps, the toaster pops up, and the EGK machine flatlines. The William Tell overture stops abruptly, The canned laughter echoes as it fades out and the somber piano plays the death march. A grinning Grim Reaper appears, brandishing a handwritten game over sign. That's it, the end, Finn. And of course, if the prophecy gets it completely wrong, ain't nobody gonna turn up at the Katoon Vishun shrine wanting to fill out a complaint form. George, who's now at death's door, stumbles into the shrine with a foot that's twisted around the wrong way, a car steering wheel lodged in his chest, and his face peppered with shards of broken glass. He waves his bloody stump at the monks and screams, "You told me I'd die in my fucking sleep!" He spits out bits of broken teeth and dashboard. "I want my fucking gold back!"